I would imagine that every CPU designer dreams of the day when their design finally ends up in actual hardware. Thanks to a collaboration with Dr. Kevin Walsh, that dream has come true for me. For those who don't know, Kevin wrote the various extra Logisim components in the Cornell version of Logisim, and created his own version of Logisim Evolution now that he's at Holy Cross. I hope this development doesn't upset the couple of people who requested my circuit and I said no. Kevin not only asked first, but he asked before I decided not to distribute my circuit. But this collaboration will help everyone, since Kevin tells me he used my circuit to make his version of Logisim even faster, so everyone ultimately wins. I'll cover the speedups later. I'll start by showing what I gave Kevin. It was the latest version of my design at the time he requested it, but I've added a lot since then, though some additions wouldn't likely be able to be put in an FPGA, or at least not a relatively inexpensive one. I'm also showing it using the version of Kevin's Logisim that was available around that time. Now, here's my design modified by Kevin. Most of the changes are cosmetic, and most of the non-cosmetic changes involve the removal of gated clocks. Gated clock means that a component is clocked by other components, such as gates, rather than a clock. If you saw one of my previous videos, you'll know I said I got rid of pretty much all gated clocks. So you might wonder, what gated clocks did Kevin remove? Well, I only got rid of the gated clocks that would be synthesized into an FPGA, since the removals were done because the synthesization process indicated there might be timing problems due to gated clocks. Kevin got rid of all gated clocks, even those parts of the circuit that wouldn't be in the FPGA implementation. I'll try to quickly run through the changes. The NOT gates on the value displays were removed, so now the displays default to off. The pull-down resistors on the value displays were also removed, meaning the displays won't indicate zeros if the input is floating. The controlled buffers on the displays were changed to controlled drivers, allowing them to be synthesized. The 7-input OR gate on the MIDI device, which turned off the device if the volume was zero, was changed to a comparator. The pull-down resistor on the keyboard was removed. The AND gate used with the device select decoder was removed. A demux is used instead, which also removes the AND gate for the store to RAM and the pull-down resistor. Changes to the fetch execute cycle circuitry, which I'll show later, changes the colors and behavior of the CPU state LED. And finally, the CLK clock line is used to clock the RAM, RTC clock register, LED matrix, keyboard, frequency and volume registers, XY coordinate register, and video display, which removes all gated clocks from this part of the design. Now the ALU changes. Byte and word swappers were added for some reason, but they are not used by the control ROM. A few unused components that I wasn't sure I wanted to add were disconnected. I removed those from newer versions of my design anyway. Now for the changes to the CPU. Cosmetically, this was changed a lot. As for the non-cosmetic changes, the JK flip-flop in the fetch-execute cycle circuitry was changed to an SR flip-flop, which removes the gated clock and also removes the need for the AND. The consequence of this change is that the start button now requires the clock to be running when pressed, otherwise it has no effect. The mux on the instruction register was removed. That mux really didn't do anything, but for some reason I can't remember, I put it there in my original on-paper homework assignment. The priority encoders on the muxes on the address bus and the Y register were removed because the muxes were changed to priority muxes. And the priority encoder on the mux on the A register that I had to put in to make it work in GHDL was removed. There is a mistake in the redesign here, but it's probably due to my imprecise labeling of one of the lines. The M2A control line shouldn't be connected to the A register. I probably should have labeled it M2AB for address bus, since it's used to select the value going to the address bus. But I figure I was thinking that it was a line necessary to send a value from memory to the A register, so I was describing reason rather than function, if you know what I mean. Kevin later fixed that on his own. For the control ROM, instead of a mux or pull-down resistor, a control driver is used instead. Here's the priority mux. A PLA is used to implement the priority logic. No changes to the compare circuitry. Here's the LED matrix circuitry. An AND gate was added to allow software resets only when the device is enabled. Here's the controlled driver I mentioned before. That covers all the changes I noticed. In order to put the circuit into an FPGA, the non-synthesizable components have to be removed. Here's one version of the removal. Also, the RAM size is reduced. Here's another version meant to be put in a Thoracic DE0 Nano FPGA board, and it also has a smaller RAM. More importantly, it uses a trimmed-down ALU. I don't know why the multiplication and division components were removed. Maybe at that time, Kevin's Logisim couldn't synthesize these components. Or maybe they were removed so the design would fit into the Nano. I don't know. But this change to the ALU means that a new version of the CPU that uses the trimmed-down ALU is required. These various versions can now all be simulated independently by using the Simulate tab I'll show later. Here's a new feature of Kevin's version of Logisim. It allows the RAM to load files of many different formats, and it will make an initial guess as to the format of the file. This is what I was referring to when I said Kevin made his version a lot faster. It now has many clock speeds above the previous 4 kHz maximum. I haven't looked at the source code, but I would imagine that he achieves these speeds by doing the same thing video players do when the hardware or internet connection can't keep up with the speed of the video. In that case, frames are dropped. Due to the nature of most compression algorithms, the dropped frames are still processed, just not displayed. So likewise, in this Logisim, I believe that the logic state changes of the components are still being processed, just not always shown. If you need to know precisely how the logic states change, you would need to select a lower clock speed. But Kevin's speedups go beyond this. He apparently used a code profiler to find out where the code was slowing things down. Another new feature of Kevin's Logisim is the state list. It lists the current values of various components. Here's the Simulate tab I mentioned before. You can select which circuit simulations you want to run and also see which subcircuits each simulation uses. I'll try synthesizing the nano circuit to a Thoracic DE0 Nano. I'll select VHDL and show that I already inputted the various paths. The components need to be mapped to the FPGA board being used. I don't know if this board can do everything needed, so I'll select Disconnected for some of these components. Every component has to be assigned to something in order to continue, so if you don't know what to assign to, select Disconnected. I'll speed this up so it won't be boring. I don't have an FPGA board, so I'll stop here. These are the options you can select. By the way, for some things, you would have to select a slower speed. One example is the kit or Cylon effect in my program. You may have noticed that the text displayed in the TTY screen now goes beyond the borders of the TTY screen. This is because the font doesn't scale along with the zoom level. Zooming to 100% solves this problem. Now I'll show some footage that Kevin shot, but with overlays added by me. Here, I assume since Kevin is using a Thoracic DE0 instead of a Nano, he chose to synthesize more of the design. However, many of the components had to be removed because they couldn't be synthesized or didn't have equivalents on the DE0. The FPGA is starting up. There's even a kit effect for free. And now, the design is transferred to the FPGA board. The CPU is ready to run the program. So the start button is pressed. It's the simple program shown earlier in Logisim. It behaves correctly in responding to keyboard input. Now the CPU is reset, and then the CPU is started again, just to show that everything works. By the way, the 7-segment displays are showing the lower 16 bits of the instruction being executed. They are showing 8808 because the CPU is running at 25 MHz, which is too fast to see the individual values. Most just blend together in an 8. Also, the CPU cycle state LED appears constantly lit rather than blinking. Here's how the board would behave if the design was downloaded again. So, in order to show the 7-segment displays better, Kevin added the ability to select the speed of the CPU on the fly. This was achieved by using the dynamic clock control component that's under the BFH megafunctions component list category. By the way, the previously synthesized design is easier to see now. Note, this version has a different RAM size. It is also clear that this version of the CPU is a little different than the one shown earlier. The M2A line was removed from the A register, as I talked about before. The control ROM was reduced in size, and the control lines were reorganized, which means the values in the ROM had to be recomputed. The M2A line was renamed to M2AB to better reflect its function. And the MUX on the Y register appears to now be back to being a normal MUX, rather than a priority MUX, but without the priority encoder. By the way, it appears that the full ALU is being used rather than the trimmed down one, but I'm not sure. The dynamic clock control divides the main clock by the value selected. Here's a table of the values and their meanings. Dynamic speed must be selected here to use the dynamic clock control with the FPGA board. Here, Kevin shows how he assigned some of the various components to the FPGA board. For the dip switch, the component had to be switched from dip switch to expanded in order to assign the individual switches. The down arrow allows you to change the setting. Likewise, the speed control had to be switched from ribbon to expanded in order to assign the individual pins. And the RGB LED had to be switched to expanded from RGB LED, since the DE0 doesn't have RGB LEDs. Now, the new speed control will be tested. The three rightmost switches set the speed. The instructions can now clearly be seen, and the CPU cycle state LED blinks. The leftmost switch turns the instruction display on and off, and by off, I mean all zeros. Here's another run of it. Setting it to 100 Hz now shows the 8808 again, but it's clear the 8808 isn't constant. And faster speeds show a solid 8808. Well, it's been quite a journey from my on-paper CPU design homework assignment to actual hardware. I would like to thank Kevin for his work on improving Logisim and also his work putting my design in hardware. Kevin tells me he would like to implement the video screen, but due to the limited size of the DE0's internal RAM, the screen would have to be low-res VGA with reduced color resolution, but it should be doable. Off-chip memory could be used, which would allow a better display, but would require driver code to be written. We'll see how this progresses. If you haven't done so yet, please subscribe, like, share, comment, etc. And if you click subscribe, click the bell to receive notifications of future videos.